I'm in the movies.
Buildings that defy expectations. The impossible realized. All products of one extraordinary imagination. The architect, Frank Gehry.
Most of what's built isn't architecture. We know what the greatness is. We deny it in favor of banality.
His buildings embellish cities across the globe. And now, a Gehry will grace Australia, taking its place among Sydney's celebrated landmarks.
Frank Gehry is perhaps one of the world's most famously provocative architects. His buildings both intrigue and ignite. Frankly, there's no comfortable middle ground with Gehry.
For Frank, rules are there to be broken.
You get a sense of what this facade does when you get down here.
I'd say building that's been crushed, that's my interpretation.
Oh, I'm just thinking what he was smoking.
It's so out of the ordinary. Walls doing things that they shouldn't be doing.
It's not going to be able to be done. No, I just thought, you're bending the ruler too much.
Well, the most common assumption is that he's like the greatest architect in the world, and they're right.
It's vulgar, it's showy, it screams out for attention like a child throwing a tantrum in a supermarket.
He's got an ego, but how can you not have an ego to build things like this?
I just think Frank's buildings make you smile.
So what will Sydney make of him? And what will Frank make of Sydney?
Almost 20 years ago, Frank Gehry's Guggenheim Museum of Art in Bilbao catapulted him to global fame. He hasn't looked back since. Here at Gehry's LA studio, a surprisingly unassuming exterior belies a vast hive of architectural creativity within. Models for presidential memorials, skyscrapers, and Facebook's new HQ cover every available surface. Everything in this place comes from inside Frank's head, even the furniture. The actor Brad Pitt has spent time here as an informal apprentice, yet another drawn to Frank's flame. And it's all the more impressive, given that Gehry is now well into his 80s.
I've always had this forward thing. I find it hard to give up. I don't like to give up. I don't give up.
You've got this big machine in here, this incubator, which is...
Well, I didn't have it in the start. I made the models myself. I did all the drawings myself, and for some years, for several years. But I've held to those values, and I've worked out my language through the sketches and the models. Now, this is heartening. Heartening.
I've heard him say it so many times, if I knew where I was going, I wouldn't go there.
in every way, your buildings have a kind of energy which says that they're not necessarily going to do what you expect them to do.
Only because I'm looking for a way to express feeling and movement. Most buildings have no sense of humanity. They're cold and lifeless and have, you know, they're not welcoming to people. Nothing's ever perfect. So that's a good thing, I think. So I like the buildings to look like they're in progress.
If any of the designs look like something we've ever done before, they're out. And if any of the designs look like anything anybody else has ever done before, they're out. So with those kind of ground rules, it forces us to invent new stuff all the time.
Australia, however, has a somewhat checkered history when it comes to bold new structures.
Sydney is famous for two great 20th century landmarks. Sydney Harbour Bridge, first conceived by a convict, Francis Greenway, a bankrupt English architect, transported to Australia for the crime of forgery. And of course, the Sydney Opera House, designed by an idealistic Dane who built very little before and who was unceremoniously dumped. It's a miracle that either of these masterworks were ever realized.
Every city in the world has a bunch of ugly buildings and very few good ones, and Sydney is the same. With great pain, they got the Sydney Opera House. It's been an icon that's paid off.
But it's this stark concrete tower block that's drawn Frank Gehry to Sydney. It's been the University of Technology's most recognizable building for over 30 years. But now it seems it's time for something new.
The university seemed to be ready to take a risk. We want people to think differently about business. We want people in this country to think more creatively.
They want, it's something everybody wants. All clients want. They want a landmark, iconic building that will be a symbol for them of the future, where they're going.
In fact, the UTS team had already seen a building they liked in America. An unlikely-looking business school designed by a self-proclaimed dreamer.
And the kind of building we would like is, well, something of the kind the architect Frank Gehry would construct.
Frank was just sitting in his desk and got a call. Frank said, I've been waiting for 30 years for someone to call me to do a building in Sydney or in Australia.
Frank fired off a four-word text. I'm up for it.
Well, I didn't believe it could possibly be true. We knew once we were on the road with Frank Gehry, it would be very hard to turn back.
Usually we're going into a place and doing something that nobody's ever done before, seen before. So there's some resistance, some skepticism, some, you know, you can't do that.
Maybe he was just doing a couple of doodles one day and thought, yeah, I'll doodle on a doodle on a doodle, and then there we have it.
These are the sketches that Frank undertook at the pizza restaurant, and I managed to rip aside part of the tablecloth, and it's putting the building in the context of its surroundings. He's musing on where things will fit in that space. Ultimately, however, this emerged, which is the
treehouse design with the trunk of social spaces branching into discipline areas and research groups.
And I called it the treehouse. I was drawing it, then we were talking. I said, it's kind of like a treehouse. Roy picked it up like God had just, which was embarrassing.
It's like naming a child.
Yeah, and he got all excited about it. So I said, okay, if you're happy, I'm happy.
You get a sense of what this facade does when you get down here. It's not.
Roy's enthusiasm wasn't universally shared.
Various levels.
When Frank first revealed his working model, some critics described his design as a crushed paper bag, others a termite's nest.
I think it's dead ugly. It looks like a pile of old cardboard beer cartons left out in the rain for the rubbish man to collect.
There's a little bit of disdain within the community. I guess jealousy maybe plays into it a little bit.
With impossibly curved brick walls, an explosion of logs for the central teaching area, and a surreal steel staircase, it was also unknown territory for those charged with actually building it.
When I first saw the design, I didn't know how we were going to go about building it. Apart from the floors being level, there's nothing square, there's nothing plumb, everything's curved. I hadn't actually heard of Frank Gehry before I started here, so I wasn't too impressed.
They want to know in Sydney what you think of them, and then, of course, they're going to tell you what they think of you.
A number of years ago, I visited and I gave a talk at UTS. And they had just built the building that, where they're housed, the concrete one with the tower. It was very much like Toronto 50 years ago.
The Toronto of Frank's youth. The son of Polish immigrants, Gehry, born Goldberg, grew up in Canada during the Great Depression. The only Jewish child in his elementary school, he was beaten up for killing Christ. Salvation came in the form of culture. His mother introduced him to classical music concerts at Toronto's Massey Hall. And she took him to the city's art gallery, inspiring a lifelong passion for painting, sculpture and music.
He grew up in somewhat tough surroundings. I think those sort of toughened him up a certain amount. So the combination of toughness and grit and yet a love of cultural things all do come from his childhood. He also had a very close relationship to his grandmother.
She and Frank would sit there and play with these pieces of wood. They'd make little cities, they'd make bridges, they'd make streets. And years later, when he was trying to decide what he wanted to be, he remembered those moments and he remembered how exciting it was to be able to create something like that. And to do it the way you wanted to.
At the same time, his Orthodox grandfather, Samuel, ingrained in Frank a questioning approach to life.
I think that comes from my childhood, studying Talmud with my grandfather. Everything is why, right? Question everything. And why not? And why isn't it? And why can't I?
In his late teens, Frank and the family headed west to Los Angeles in search of a fresh start. yet, this 21st century star architect began his new life working as a truck driver.
I was 17 and we were very poor. I was a deer in the headlights. I had to get a job and work hard. Studying architecture, once I got there, I appreciated LA.
What you have to remember about Los Angeles in 1947 is it was an incredibly different place than it is today. The frontier spirit of the city ignited something in him as well. Through the 50s and the early 60s, when he was just starting out in his career, Los Angeles was growing along with him.
We could say that his childhood in Canada was formative. LA was transformative. It opened whole new vistas, literally and psychologically, to him.
I was living with a bunch of painters and sculptors, and I was a vacuum cleaner, you know, not consciously, but unconsciously, I was picking up stuff and picking up more methods and way of thinking, of trying things. We could work under the radar. New York didn't care. Europe didn't care. Nobody cared.
Okay. I'll sing. I'm very eclectic, and I steal ideas from everybody. I'm more into the illusionary qualities of a building and creating a sort of a visual richness without it being there. You almost have to trip over it. I feel like I've pursued a loner course out here, partly because of my conviction about developing personal things. The work of Donald Judd fascinates me. It's sort of using cheap materials and getting a lot of response out of it.
The idea of creating architecture with equally modest materials was a striking feature of Gehry's most significant early building, his own home.
I think certainly his house, his first unbridled expression of a bunch of ideas, where the notion of new and old and unfinished and raw and finished all clashing together was first expressed. It was definitely a pretty radical thing to look at. He bought an old pink, of all things, pink Dutch colonial house, about as ordinary and conventional a suburban house as you could imagine, and then proceeded to sort of partly deconstruct it, expand it, alter it, and radically transform it. And yet, the original house never disappeared. You could always see elements of the original house in it.
I think he made a breakthrough with the house. It's funky, because LA is kind of tinny and, you know, mesh and stuff like that. Also the idea of collage, to collage them together. And that was a very kind of refreshing moment to be almost abstract. His connection to the art world inspired him.
The trigger for me was Rauschenberg, certainly, because I was trained to be perfect. Perfect detailing, edges, everything just right. I started doing small houses and remodeling, and the clients couldn't afford perfect craftsmanship. I was looking at Rauschenberg's work. And I thought, what if we make a virtue out of the bad workmanship? What if it becomes part of the palette? So what if you use it? And that's when I started to do that.
Frank isn't an architect of the precious. He's an architect of the gritty. And taking the gritty, the ordinary, the chain link, and elevating it into something that has art in it.
I picked a material that was hated universally, chain link. And I thought, I'm going to study this thing and see where the edge is. I like the idea of having the kitchen on the driveway. I would light it when we had guests over so that it looked like you were sitting on the driveway and looking at the old house. It was kind of a voyeuristic thing.
When the house was completed in 1978, the neighbors often referred to it as an eyesore.
One of them was an architecture critic, and he trained his dog to relieve itself on the house.
The guy across the road came over one day and he said, I don't get it. What are you doing? I said, I'm copying you. He said, what are you talking about? I said, well, look at your house. You're repairing your car in your front lawn. The backyard, you got two trailers, you got chain link fence, you got corrugated metal. I said, I'm using the same thing. Look, God. He said, oh, but mine's normal.
The abnormalities even spread to the furniture. Throughout the 70s, Frank designed a range of cardboard chairs whose popularity helped pay for his Santa Monica house.
A chair is a miniature design problem. It's a mini building. Almost every great architect has done a chair. And, you know, Frank's cardboard chair is so Frank, right? It's cardboard, it's crummy. And yet Frank makes it into kind of this, slightly chaotic looking thing that's above all comfortable.
Frank's love of simple industrial materials endures. His Sydney treehouse will be clad in brick, a local staple, and a choice inspired by the 19th century buildings that surround the UTS site. But at this testing workshop, his enormous challenge for Sydney's bricklayers is to somehow make these bricks curve like flowing fabric.
He must have a good mind. I don't know what he was thinking, so you're not gonna make life miserable for the bricklayer that's gonna be doing this job.
You made it more difficult, didn't you, by deciding to use bricks.
I found over the years that the craftspeople love the challenge. They get bored doing the same old stuff.
You know, the brickwork on this building is like extremely challenging.
The facade of the project, and I'll show you on my screen over here, is made out of a steel substrate, a mild steel substrate. And on this substrate, there are some ties on which the bricks rest. And the density of these ties changes depending on the curvature of the building. And the brick ties are supported on a steel frame.
That's the hardest part, to put the ties in there. As you can see the channel then, and then fix all this and the front and the back of the bricks, and then tie them up so they can stay there.
You know, the way the brick gets placed in this building is not going to be some mechanical process. It's going to be a craft of, you know, brick mason, a bricky placing each brick, and the way they place the brick and the way they strike the mortar and the way they do all this stuff is going to create, you know, we're going to live and die by how they do it.
See that one up there? The brick, back of the tail of the brick is resting on the tie, which probably means the brick is tipped back.
No, they should have dropped the carriage for the tie lower.
Time will tell if Sydney's craftsmen are up to the task.
I don't think it's a deal breaker, but it is going to cause this tipping thing to happen.
It's something that we've never done before, so we are learning. Even though bricklayers, but we're learning in this job.
The house that Frank built became the house that built Frank. 1980s LA saw a host of, well, gregarious new Gehry buildings emerge.
They weren't projects that would have given me the kind of presence in the world that I have now. But I felt like I was doing okay.
This intriguing concoction, built for the Shiat Day ad agency, was a collaboration with sculptor Klaus Oldenburg and is now Google's LA office.
I first came across the Shiat Day building in the 80s. First of all, I saw it and I didn't know what I was looking at. Oldenburg's binoculars and this sort of combination of things that shouldn't be there. And then I entered it. And I saw this extraordinary space with that beautiful whale in a corner. The staff in the place completely exhilarated.
The art is the art of living, the art of spending time in it and making it part of your life. I pay attention to that. I'm very conscious of that. Everything's for people. So if we as architects focus on that, we won't go wrong.
The Shiat Day building's eclectic interior reflected Frank's past and future preoccupations. One room created entirely from cardboard, and his whale meeting space, an early foray into metal-clad curved forms inspired by nature. This was Gehry's major international leap forward. His first creation in Europe, the Vitra Museum, saw bold curves breaking up his trademark angles.
I like trying things. I like the curiosity of it. Anything that locks you into a system, I go that way.
It was one of the first times that he really pushed formal boundaries in a new way. It predicted some of the shapes that he would be doing later on in far more powerful and dramatic ways.
Vitra was a precursor of all later work. Nobody was doing curvature at the time.
He was really beginning to incorporate new ideas into his built structures about the possibility, in particular, of bringing motion into the experience of a building. And he began using these swooping curves that made the building appear to be alive in a very interesting way.
Frank, being Frank, he had, of course, been experimenting with more than just buildings. All along.
Fish were something that attracted him. He drew fish, he built fish, he sort of lived fish. I don't know if he liked to eat them, but
fish were a big part of his life.
Since I was always looking for a way to express motion with inert materials, by chance, studying fish gave me the first inklings of how to do that.
One of the first things he did was investigate the ways that the turning and torquing of a fish's body be incorporated into a building and could perhaps give us another line of delight.
The idea that something very fluid gets built out of something really massive and rough is the kind of contradiction of that contained in that design element is really interesting.
Meanwhile, in Sydney, the bricklaying team have begun work on site, but it's not getting any easier.
Oh, I love my job.
It's so out of the ordinary. It's walls doing things that they shouldn't be doing.
Well, I reckon it's a I think this panel here is worse than the test panel we've done in the lab because it's a bit higher, but just by looking at it, it's scary.
He always tries to create a certain element of tension in his work or movement. With this one, I think there's quite an interesting tension between an element like, or a material like brick doing things that say the flowing curtains do.
If you go back in history, in the art world, the fold has always been a fascination. With Michelangelo, he spent endless hours drawing the fold. So it's clearly a manifestation that has some resonance with humanity. And I say it happens because it's primitive, because when you're in your mother's arms, you're enveloped in folds.
They go this way.
In UTS, we made the public areas part of the folds, so that the communal spaces that the people are going to meet in, meeting rooms, the cafes and all that, are treated with this eccentric kind of facade.
This playful facade.
Playful facade. And when it's done, we'll see if it was worth it.
But eccentric facades of this complexity don't just happen.
We digitize the design that has been created by the design team and analyze the design for constructability. And we figure out areas which are not buildable, and you can see these areas in red over there. And then what we do is very closely work with the design team to kind of remove these areas in the design phases so that we don't have to do these changes once the buildings go out for bidding or go out for construction. Yellow means that there would be lots of additional ties because the surfaces are leaning in or surfaces are leaning out.
I'm very into this computer stuff, but I don't know how to turn it on. I'm totally below compass mentis.
Somewhat ironic, given that Frank is now the go-to architect for tech titans like Facebook, and that digital technology has been crucial to his success.
If Frank Gehry had lived 50 years earlier, he might not be Frank Gehry. He might be a lesser Frank Gehry. The fact that he lived at the cusp of the digital age and at the introduction of the digital age enabled him to realize his dreams in a way that really he might not have otherwise.
Make it in a conduit or a dashed line or something? Yeah, but
if you had to pick one building over the last 20 years, one building that stood for this time in architecture, that expressed its technology, its aspirations, its effect on cities, that would be the building.
I defy anyone to stand in front of that museum and say it's not one of the most beautiful things they've ever seen.
The greatest moment of Bilbao is when you see it for the first time against the cityscape. You see that this extraordinary, unusual form that in one way looks completely different from anything around it, but in another way really does respond to the nature of that site, to the industrial past of this port and shipping city.
But the museum's riverfront location was never part of the original plan.
They gave me an in-town building that had a 19th century brick wall around it with turrets at the corners. I'm a brave sucker sometimes. I said, I think it's a terrible site for the museum. After dinner, we went up on the hill, and they said, well, where would you put it? And I said, there, by the bridge. There was a crumbling brick factory there. By some miracle, I got it.
How do you even manage to point to a place and say, I'd like that, and it happens?
Well, I'd had a few drinks.
With a new site agreed, the building he came up with fused great 20th century leaps forward in both art and engineering. Picasso's cubist masterpiece, The Accordionist, helped inspire the bravura architectural forms. But these were only made technically possible by Gehry's team designing the Guggenheim with pioneering software meant for building aeroplanes.
30 years ago, I was trying to emulate the world of movement. Cars, planes, everything moving. And I couldn't build it. I tried. It was difficult and expensive. And I went to IBM, and they connected me with Dassault Systems in France. Dassault built airplanes. I knew this was the future. They gave me the stuff to try. And the first time I found success with it is we used it in Bilbao.
It achieved what Frank had really wanted to do for so long, to create an architecture of feeling, of sculptural expressiveness. It was utterly transformative. I mean, it was totally different from that kind of dark old city that it was sunk into with those emerald green mountains. But it didn't look foreign. I mean, that was the thing. It was like a spaceship that had landed, but it was a friendly spaceship, a neighborly spaceship, one that took note of what was there and just raised it up to a whole new level.
The world swooned. Some 10 million people visited the museum in a decade, with Frank's masterpiece helping generate nearly 1.6 billion euros in tourism for the Basque government.
Good news, it was cheap. The good news is it works, and the good news, people like it. Bilbao was 100 million.
Really?
$300 a square foot.
That's amazing.
I know. So it's the cheapest museum that's been built in the last years, you know.
I think the Guggenheim in Bilbao was a very important moment because it changed a lot of things. Every city wanted a Guggenheim. Finally, cities were represented by architecture, which had been a dead thing for a long time because You know, not since, for example, you know, Sydney. So it empowered the architect, and I think that was a very, very critical.
His career was never quite the same after that, and architecture was never quite the same after Bilbao.
Across the globe, a swathe of stunning works elevated Gehry to greatness.
Squeezed into this otherwise orthodox landscape is what's been unflatteringly described as the architectural equivalent of a motorway pileup.
But then, perhaps inevitably, a backlash.
It's an example of how technology and virtually unlimited resources can create what some see as a masterpiece, others as a monstrosity.
People bring their own baggage to everything, you know, their own interpretation, so... Some guy said it was a heart transplant operation that went awry. I kind of like that one. I think people will see whatever they see.
Frank's calling card is not restraint, I think it's fair to say.
Frank Gehry is the Kim Kardashian of architecture. Personal view.
But if Brad Pitt is making coffee and running around and filling the copy machine for Frank Gehry and his team, well, fuck Frank Gehry. He wins. And so I made the Fuck Frank Gehry t-shirt. His assistant called and said, Frank would like some shirts. I was happy to oblige. He wanted them in different colors.
Frank is a hockey player. He knows how to check and to check back. He's a tough guy. He can take a punch.
One side is a very sweet teddy bear. Kind of cuddly, but I don't think he's like that. You don't achieve all that by being a pussycat.
The critical voices got a sterner rebuff in 2014 when a Spanish journalist inquired as to whether Frank's architecture was just about spectacle.
Let me tell you guys that the world we live in, 98% of the buildings built are pure shit. There's no sense of design
or respect for humanity, for judgment, for anything.
Dumb buildings, right?
Son malditos edificios y ya está.
He later apologized, blaming the outburst on jet lag.
I ask this now, when just for fun, when I give a lecture. How many people in this room think my buildings are expensive? I said, how many people in this room think I'm a prima donna?
I think the hallmarks of Frank's work are bravery and the pleasure principle. He's willing to look into extraordinary new forms, not just so that he can brandish his own identity and ego, but because he thinks there's actually something in there for all of us.
Sometimes Frank's forms aren't immediately obvious.
There are beautiful limestone walls with square cuts around most sides of that building. And then you go inside, and it houses a giant conference center in the shape of a distorted horse's head.
And it came from an image I had. And I don't know where it came from, but it popped into my head.
Was that a conscious decision? Was it just something that came to you?
Yeah, that's the lantern. I was fantasizing a shape like that. It was a competition, so we didn't have time to really design the conference room. So I told the guys, put that in model. We won the competition. And I had a meeting with the bank at the time. And I said, look, you don't have to have this shape. They said, that's why we picked you.
If you're going to commission Frank Gehry, you know, you're in for probably a nightmare. You're going to get something that people are going to talk about, that half of the people are going to hate, and that half of people are going to love.
So what other talking points is Frank offering Sydney? Well, unexpected teaching areas for a start.
The Oval Classroom is going to be a contrary. It's a rougher element. It's heavy timber, stacked heavy timber, almost like a log cabin. The pieces are oversized and, you know, as you look at it, it looks a little unrefined.
We certainly don't have any carpenters that have ever cut a piece of timber that weighs 2 ton in half before. I mean, Frank's obviously got an element of craziness about him.
I suppose I should be nervous, but I have great confidence in Frank and commitment to the journey that we're on.
I think the response of everyone at UTS was, what happened to the twisted metal?
They wanted something special. And so we made the stairway.
It's a very generous stairway.
Right, they can sit around it.
Every time we bring a piece in, people are blown away, and they're only getting bigger and bigger, so it's going to be pretty wild.
We had to actually get one of the guys 6'1", 6'2", to stand next to the panels in the photo so we could actually look at them and go, how are we going to get these in? It's out there, it's wacky, it's going to be awesome when all the plastic comes off and you see the mirror finish.
And it's just polished to a mirror. So it will be very interesting when it's all done. It'll look quite amazing.
Something amazing was exactly what Chicago needed in 1996, when early plans for the city's Millennium Park were jettisoned by its lead patron.
I was shocked. These plans, and I'm not kidding, had gaslight. And so I turned to a friend of mine and I said, what millennium are we talking about?
Something boring in America's premier city of architecture. Cindy sent out a mayday.
I said, if they could get Frank Gehry, that would be the art. They don't need anything else.
When it was first announced that he was doing the Pritzker Pavilion, it just struck me as bizarre. I mean, I wrote in the paper that it was kind of like asking Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart and Jimi Hendrix to play a duet together. It just seemed like there could never be harmony. When he came to Chicago, he was very cognizant of the fact that this was a city of bone-beautiful buildings, buildings that express the steel that holds them up. So Frank kind of took that and he spun it in his own California digital way to create this, you know, structurally, I mean, bare-bone, ellipse-shaped trellis. But it shapes this incredible room, this outdoor room, and it's become a place. It isn't just structure, it's place, it's community.
I think people are very proud of it. It's very joyful to see that people appreciate it and love it and feel that that's their park. Because it is, it's a people's park.
Learning from history, the buildings that somehow seem to deserve iconicity are concert halls, city halls, libraries, courthouses. I really believe in that.
Public spaces.
Yeah. So those kind of buildings I've invested with that kind of effort to make them the best you can do, and that works.
As with Bilbao, Frank's iconic buildings have a wider impact. His Chicago pavilion dramatically increased local real estate values. And this Gehry effect is exactly what some in Sydney are banking on too, with hopes that the UTS building will help regenerate the whole industrial neighbourhood it's part of.
There's a calculated risk with Frank Gehry. You know he'll pull it off. His buildings will become famous. So you sort of buy into that energy. I think the Gehry building will definitely reorientate the compass to this end of town. And I think what has always been the sort of service end of Sydney, the ports, Darling Harbour, the dirty end of town.
Frank Gehry rolls into town with his crew and his ideas into a town depressed. There's mostly liquor stores, crime, dirt, whores everywhere. And here comes Frank to change everything. And you know what? Probably will.
Wants his things to connect to place. He may not do it in a literal way. He may not do it as other architects do. But he does not design funny shapes in his office disconnected from anything and then plop them into some place. I mean, that's very much not what he does.
I don't wake up in the middle of the night and say, oh, let's do a thing. That doesn't interest me.
Although Frank's buildings are always very different in appearance from their surroundings, Frank pays a lot of attention to his surroundings and incorporates aspects of them into the building when he's making it.
Frank's design response to the UTS building's unglamorous location is to reflect it.
The eastern elevation is all brickwork. The basic idea of that is when you're standing in the city and you look west, all you see is brick facades everywhere. So it blends into the existing buildings. On the western elevation, if you're looking towards the city, you're looking at glass and you're looking at glass buildings. Hence, glass on the west, brickwork on the east.
When you do a building, you're organizing it around a bunch of principles. You don't mimic the environment you're in. That's a big one. So you deal with the scale and the relationships, so you're not giving them a finger. You create a kind of a relationship.
The avalanche of glazing comes in bespoke pieces from China. Each section takes about 8 weeks to arrive and costs around £16,000. It's rather a lot of money to have dangling from the end of a crane.
Stop.
Hoist down, mate.
Down.
They're not gonna make it, I'll make it.
Hook down,
Michael.
Fuck
it.
Bring it down,
Scott. I've cancelled the lift for the moment because it's too windy. It's over 35 k's and I'm going out to the south. Not happy with it at the moment.
Sometimes it goes bang, 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 bang. Get 20 in a day, but sometimes it doesn't work out that way, especially with all the angles of this one.
They're different, very different. It'd be amazing when it's done, but very different.
Really cool. Reckon it looks good, all these different angles. The brickwork looks good. It's gonna look sick.
Glass isn't the only issue on site. Despite two-thirds of the brickwork being complete, the problems keep on coming for Gus and his team.
Yesterday, the architect and the engineer, they went around and they picked up a few little mistakes. So they took some photos, shows exactly where the mistakes are. It's hard for them, and it's hard for me too, because, you know, I need to check and make sure that everything is done the right way, but I can't see every single thing. All right, guys, you can see the pictures here. It was in this panel here, okay? We had all the ties were too short. Okay, just remember, all the ties have to come into the channel. All right, small plate in the back, big plate inside the channel. Yeah? Let's make sure it doesn't happen again, please. Because it makes us look like we don't know what we're doing. Okay?
It's harder to take it down than what it is to put it up. So try not to make mistakes.
It's not easy to create architecture. It affects people, it moves people, it touches their emotions and works with the city in ways that a simple building can't.
I think the New York building is tremendously important. Not only because it's the tallest thing he's done, and it's in the city of skyscrapers. It represents another element in his quest to be radical and conventional at the same time.
He rethought the curtain wall by making it literally a curtain, except it's a shimmering metal curtain, and it catches the light very beautifully. It looks great from both the Brooklyn side and the New Jersey side. It's very visible, especially in Lower Manhattan. It's a real, it's a monument on the skyline, and it changes all the time. Because of the light and the material that it's addressed in.
The Beekman Building is talking to the Woolworth Building. The Woolworth Building, in my opinion, is number one, the important.
The very first of those buildings. In
yeah. I ain't gonna mess with that guy. I'm gonna be nice guy to that guy. And the client wanted me to put a hat on and I refused. I said, we're not gonna mimic. We're gonna talk to, we're gonna be polite, and we're gonna build a New York skyscraper. And that's, I think, what we did.
From a cascading skyscraper in New York to a riot of sales in Paris, Guerra's determination to find new ways of expressing movement remains insatiable. Moored at the edge of the Bois de Boulogne Park, this sleek armada is a foundation dedicated to contemporary art and culture.
An aerial view of this building shows the Bois de Boulogne and this thing in the middle of it. And then you see the Eiffel Tower and the Arc de Triomphe. It's heavy duty association. I sail, and the thing you like about sailing is that it's natural. You play with the wind and you play with these sails and you get movement. Having a bunch of sailing ships, like a regatta in the Bois de Boulogne, with the changing light, it was just thrilling to me. As I lived here for a year, 1960, with kids, we were very poor. I knew the Bois de Boulogne if I brought the kids to the Jardin. Two little girls, one of them passed away a few years ago. So it's very poignant to come here with knowing she isn't here or can't come. at the end of the war, we were all fascinated with simplicity. And there was a whole minimalist thing that somehow made sense, even though I didn't completely buy into it personally. And it seemed to be the antithesis of
human nature.
Human nature and how we want to live. If you look at Picasso's studio, it's filled with all kinds of stuff. And my friend's studios were always filled with all kinds of stuff. That seems very normal and human, and I love that.
Understanding the risks that are involved in doing architecture like this speaks volumes about the braveness that is Frank. You know, I think that it rubs off on everybody else here. I think that when you see that and know that he is taking that risk, you want to do your best for him.
This job is the first job that I really enjoy coming to work. It's never happened before, and it's amazed me, actually, but you enjoy waking up in the morning, you enjoy coming into work because we're really getting to show off our skills here.
When craftspeople get into the process, then and they finally kind of get with it, then there's a huge amount of pride and workmanship that comes out of that.
The lighting, the shading, it's just, it does. It looks like it's moving. It's just changing continuously all day long. And I imagine if they put the right lighting and everything, that'll continue through the night as well.
And for Tony, this career highlight needs permanently acknowledging.
Frank Gehry's inspirational, I guess, in the way that he's thought outside the box, and I just don't understand why no one's ever thought like the way he has before.
You know, for the most part, it's like a box on top of a box on top of another box next to a box, and this isn't like that.
That's all completely out of the ordinary, and just it's amazing to be down on the ground looking up and say I built that. It's pretty cool.
The last brick in the front.
In my hometown, when we finish a house, we bless it. So we grab a bottle of wine and we smash against the wall, or a bottle of grappa, whatever it's in handy. But here, I brought a bottle of champagne today, and I'm gonna bless it with this. Thank Christ, this job is done. Salute. To you, Chow Chak, too.
Could not possibly have envisaged what emerged at the end. It must be a leap of faith because you don't know what you're going to get.
We won't see what this building looks like until it's finished and they take the scaffolding off. It's a striptease. It goes on over 3 or 4 weeks and they come down from the top and the beauty or the ugliness is revealed.
Just get
get you, Frank, to explain the staircase to us?
I can't.
You can't? It just happened.
Wonderfully eye-catching.
So the nice thing is it was handmade.
Yeah.
Hand-laid brick.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, it looks wonderful.
What do you think are the building's greatest architectural achievements?
Well, one of the greatest architectural achievements, it's got built on time and budget.
A very simple question. Are you happy with it? What do you think of it now that it's done?
Oh boy. So, I'm Jewish and I feel guilty about everything. You know, it takes me 2 years to come around. I see all the things I would change and want to change. And actually, I wouldn't change. Certainly, it gives them a spirit of invention that nothing's fixed. And as soon as you think you know the right way to do something, somebody will come up with something, some way to take you off on another adventure.
I think that Frank is having one of the greatest later life creative surges in history. You'd have to compare it to like the late quartets of Beethoven, the things that people look at as great late expressions. The productions of the last 10 years have been some of the most delightful of his entire career.
I don't mind if you don't like it. I'm sure I'm not perfect and can't do everything right, always right. You want to do good things. You want to be part of making things better. And that's a nice feeling when you can feel like you've made something that makes people happy. I still do it for that reason.
Are you still looking for yourself?
I don't think about it that way anymore, but I think I found myself. I continue to be curious. I keep moving on, but that's the central theme, I guess, is curiosity and then the opportunities of the people you meet along the way. Hey, well, that's the guy.
That's
pretty good.
The tattoo, yeah.
You know what we call that pattern, the earthquake pattern?
Yeah.
Oh, you know it.
Yeah. The shop was fun. It was awesome. It was good to come to work every day. Even when we're finishing off, still looking up, it was still mind-blowing every day. Just want to thank you for designing a building the way you have.
Where do you want me to sign it?
I thought. There.
But then if you lay the brick, you can't see.
Oh, I'm not going to lay this one.
Work invigorates him. He's not tired of it. He has a whole lot of other ideas that he hasn't yet gotten to. And I think that drives him more than anything else right now. Whether his work can go on without him is a question on many people's minds, including his own.
We have to figure a way that the office can exist when I leave. I'm 84, so nobody's been good at this, at succession.
So do you think about legacy?
I'm trying to. But the guys out here tell me to stop it. You know, they say, look, have fun, keep going, we'll figure it out. You know, when the time comes, we'll figure it out.
One, two. Thank you.